A very warm welcome to all of you. Hope everyone will be fine and celebrated their Eid holidays very well according to the current situation. The Department of Sociology and Fatma Jinnah Women University Journal Club is organizing this workshop on the title Writing Literature Review and Its Critical Analysis. This is the second workshop in the series of online workshop organizing by the Department of Sociology and Journal Club on different topics related to conducting and writing research theses and research articles. The first workshop was conducted on reference management using Mendeley software, which was a success and attended by a large number of students, staff, and faculty members of Fatma Jinnah Women University. So this second workshop will focus on how to search and write academic literature review. Before starting the formal session, let me introduce the core team of this workshop. I myself, Dr. Adila Rehman, assistant professor and in charge Department of Sociology, is organizing this workshop. Dr. Sajda Naz, assistant professor, Department of Behavioral Sciences, will be the lead facilitator for this workshop. And her co-facilitators are Ms. Sadia Panni, lecturer, Department of Education, and Ms. Nosheen Naz, assistant director, Quality Enhancement Cell. Let me just share the objectives of this workshop are to acquire knowledge on how to conduct a quality literature search, and then to understand how to write and how to organize a literature review, and also to learn how to avoid plagiarism in writing literature review. The format of this 2 hours workshop is like we are having 3 sessions. First sessions will be conducted by Dr. Sajda Naz on introduction to literature review and how to search literature review effectively. The second session will be conducted by Ms. Sadia Panni, and she will discuss about the process of writing literature review, how to plan and organize literature review. And the last very important session will be delivered by Ms. Nosheen Naz to highlight some of the issues related to plagiarism, which she, as a focal person of Turnitin software, frequently encountered in checking students' theses. So I think without any further delay, let's start our first session. I will request Dr. Sajda to please proceed.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. I hope everybody is keeping well. I would like to thank Dr. Adila Rehman to having creating this opportunity. This is a nice platform for all the budding researchers and particularly for the young students who are at different level of their research thesis. And hopefully by the end of today's session, we will learn some of the things, and we will be able to apply some of the tools that we will discuss today in our thesis, our research articles. So let's begin by, I hope you can see my screen though.
Not yet, Sajda.
Let me know, because I think it's uploading yet.
Yes, now we can see.
It is available? Okay.
Yes, it is.
चले फॉर्मली हम लिटरेचर रिव्यू की वर्कशॉप का आगाज करते हैं ब्रीफली जस्ट शेयरिंग विद यू अदीला हैज ऑलरेडी शेयर्ड विद यू दैट टुडेज वर्कशॉप इज स्प्लिट इनटू 3 different parts द फर्स्ट पार्ट दैट आई विल बी फोकसिंग ऑन हैज 2 objectives फर्स्टली आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट इफेक्टिव सर्चिंग स्ट्रेटजीज रिलेटेड टू द लिटरेचर रिव्यू aiming at learning some of the techniques or tools that we can use to make our search for the literature effective. And after finishing with that, I will link it with how we can organize the searched literature for the later part of conducting or organizing the literature review, which is related to the synthesis and write-up. Part of it is being covered by the session number 2, Ms. Sadia Panni. So before we begin, we would like to touch upon some of the basic information related to the literature review. I suppose most of you are already familiar with what literature review is and why it is necessary. Speaking of the need for revisiting the literature review, it depends on the kind of literature review you are undertaking, whether you are working on your dissertation or thesis, or whether you are working on a research article, primary focus of the literature review is going to be to guide you towards the general or specific relevance of range of particular literature that is available on the topic. And certainly literature review is one of the most important steps in the entire research process. And while we apply literature review techniques in certain stages of the literature of the entire research process, the literature review, we cannot say that it has a certain beginning point or it has a particular ending point. It continues throughout the study. So literature review is defined as a critical discussion or summary of empirical literature that is available related to the general and specific relevance to a particular area or topic of the research. And hence, we have to spend a lot of time going back and revisiting the literature, updating our knowledge about a particular topic, and refining the literature as well. Now, while talking about literature review, it's important to discuss what is the difference between a good literature review and a weak literature review. And my observation is based on the work that I review mostly of the students. And when I receive their initial chapters, I see that they are very loosely connected to each other. And although the students have fairly roughly the idea about the topic and what are the variables that they need to look into, but initial write-ups show or demonstrate that there are the paragraphs are very loosely connected, and there is repetition of material quite a lot. Very few citations are over there, and the content is not adequately summarized. And based on these observations, today workshop was organized considering for those students who want to improve on their writing skills regarding the literature. Also, speaking of a strong literature review would be the opposite of what I have described regarding a weak literature review. It needs to be well connected, obviously, and it needs to have appropriate amount of literature cited within it, and appropriate summaries needs to be presented. And most importantly, the entire literature review outline needs to be very well planned initially before you even begin your study. After defining, let's have a look at why literature review is important. Literature review serves a number of functions. Firstly, it helps us to identify the research problem for those of us, for those students particularly who are looking into the topics for the first time, where not enough literature is available. They need to perhaps refine their research questions or improve their research problem. So literature review is also going to get them some insight about how they can refine their research questions. Secondly, literature review also helps to orient about what is already known and identify the gaps in the literature in context of what is not known. Thirdly, literature review helps to determine gaps or inconsistencies in the literature, and I believe this is the most important function of the literature review, to identify what is missing within the literature. And here I would like to give you an example of one of the theses that I'm supervising. The student is looking into the impact of critical incident stress debriefing. It is an intervention that is used by the emergency workers. And they apply this intervention all across the world when they encounter traumatic incidents. And it is said and it is reported that this kind of intervention helps to improve mental health outcomes for staff, and they can focus on their work alongside. But when we looked into inconsistencies, which means that some of the literature was in favor of this intervention, which means that the clinical trials that that were run showed positive results, whereas there were a number of studies which showed the other quite opposite results as well. Which means that if there was an inconsistency, we needed to establish whether this intervention is equally useful in Pakistani setting as well. So sometimes the literature review is very useful. If you look at the literature carefully, you can identify all those inconsistencies or gaps that might be present in the literature. Moving forward quickly, there are other functions of literature. For example, discovering the unanswered questions, determining whether you need to replicate a study, which is already there, or you need to design a new study of your own, identifying relevant theoretical or conceptual framework for your study. Literature review also helps you to formulate your hypothesis, design your instruments, and similarly, a number of concerns that you might have regarding methodology. Now, literature review, doing a literature review has number of benefits. It imparts number of competencies for you. First one is that it ensures development of critical thinking skills. And the process is too tedious and laborious that eventually when you will carry out literature reviews, you will learn to look at the literature and the what it is described in the second point. You will think, write, and act academically by thinking creatively. So literature review requires a lot of time. It can be laborious and boring, but again, it is essential part of the entire research process. And ultimately, it will give you clear grasp on the content or the subject matter. Ideally, a literature review needs to incorporate these four elements. It needs to be organized around and related to the research questions you are developing. It needs to synthesize the results in a summary of what is and what is known and what is not known. Thirdly, literature review should identify the gaps or areas of controversy, as I have mentioned earlier. And lastly, literature review should help you to formulate questions that need further investigation. Now we'll look at some of the common steps that are reported in the literature review. Conducting a literature review involves a number of steps, and it includes collecting, evaluating, analyzing different sources of information. It could be primary, secondary, or tertiary, and there are mainly the five steps that are reported in the literature commonly, including the search for literature review, relevant literature. Secondly, evaluating sources, identify themes, debates, and gaps, outlining the structure, and ultimately writing your literature review. The session that I'm conducting is mainly going to focus on search for the literature review. I chose the topic of search because it is very underestimated area of the entire research process. If you go back to the literature review process, you would notice that whenever we are assigned a topic, if we are a student, if we have a topic that has that we are working upon, we don't give a massive amount of time to think about, okay, what am I going to put in my search engines, what kind of keywords are going to be better. The reason is that many a times students find themselves to be confident in their ability to search effectively, and maybe it comes out to be true for most of you that when you carry out research using certain databases, you find a literature that is very much relevant to you at the first instance, but that is not how it is always. So effective search, because it is the first step, if it is accurate and if it is well planned, the rest of the procedures of the literature review become organized automatically. So my focus will be on searching for the literature. Now, as I mentioned, when we initiate our literature review, the first question that comes to our mind is where to search and what to search. Now, speaking of what to search, if you have a topic and you know what your key variables are going to be, then you have to sort out or you have to figure out what kind of evidence is of primary interest to you. Most of the students who are doing their original research at this point in time, which means that they are going to collect their data and analyze it later, most likely to be interested in looking at the primary research evidence. And primary research evidence means all the research that is currently being undertaken, and a primary source of information will be available over there. For example, you can look at original peer-reviewed articles. Theses are also an example of primary sources of information. Isi tarah se you can include conference proceedings. These are all the kind of literature that you can look into and which qualifies as primary research data. Sometimes you want to look at secondary source of information. For example, you want to look at what kind of evidence has been reported in the past, say 5 years or 10 years, literature and you want to study the literature that has been published already, so that will be called as secondary source of information. So you can look at obviously the archival data or systematic literature reviews are also classified as secondary sources of information. And third category of search is called tertiary data. Tertiary data refers to very basic kind of search that you would come across. For example, it includes blogs, magazines. They are not evidence based. They are not factual, but they can certainly guide you towards developing background or problematization of your study. So all of these three different types of sources of information are useful. But when you begin your study or when you begin your literature review, you need to identify what source of information will be used for your study or what kind of search preference would be. Ideally, I think it is ideal that you focus more on the primary sources of information. They are more factual, they are more current and update as compared to the secondary or tertiary. A tertiary source of information certainly is of no empirical value. It definitely has something to add to the background of your data. The second point that you think about is, where am I going to carry out my research? Now, most of you would notice that whenever you do a literature, you type certain keywords that you know about your topic into the Google search engine. Google is the most, I think 90% of us rely on the Google database. Google is very intuitive software. And over the period of time, Google, especially talking about the Google Scholar, has improved its database massively. However, Google Scholar is not as authentic in terms of the kind of data it generates for you as compared to the other databases. So therefore, it is very important to know what kind of search databases are available that you can look into related to your subject area. Now, I belong to obviously the social sciences discipline, so you would notice that some of the examples that I have here are related to the social sciences. However, there are certain databases that are open for all other disciplines. For example, EBSCO Discovery is a database that includes search engines of other disciplines as well. Isi tarah se full text databases jo hain individual journals ki as well as publishers platform, isme Science Direct aa jata hai, Vilays aur deegar jo publishing platforms hain, they you can consult those as well for your study. Bibliographic databases are the most frequently used databases. Bibliographic databases means that these are collection of the evidence based or empirical research that indexed in the Scopus or the JCR. Bibliographic databases provides you access to a number of full length articles. Some of them are full length available in full length. Some of them give you access only to the abstract portion. But again, we will look into certain additional features of these databases, and they will be certainly of use to you. Examples of bibliographic database include PubMed, Scopus, and Web of Science. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with these databases, particularly those who belong to the the disciplines of health sciences or social sciences might find themselves using PubMed quite a lot. PubMed is distinct from the other bibliographic databases because it's subscription free. The Scopus and Web of Science unfortunately require institutional subscription. I'm not sure if the university, Fatma Jinnah Women University, has institutional subscription for Web of Science or Scopus. If somebody knows, maybe they can comment on it. But PubMed repository is free. And we are going to use PubMed search engine to explore the remaining examples involved in this session. Other than that, we have EBSCO Discovery, Google Scholar, of course, is useful. And then repositories, which include the thesis and other research articles. As I mentioned earlier, PubMed is publicly available. There's no subscription required. So if you type PubMed in your search engines, it will take you to directly to the search engine of PubMed. It is a search engine relying on number of several databases. Most common database that is used by PubMed is Medline. And the abstract level metadata refers to all the information, identifying information of an article, which can be about when it was published at the first instance, who was the author, what are the affiliations of author, and all the information related to that article, to the extent of abstract, will be available and accessible through these search engines. There are more than 27 million records in PubMed. Some of the resource material in PubMed goes back as 1809. So you can access very old data if there is a need. Also, PubMed has more than 14 million links to full-length articles, and nearly 4 million articles are free access. So you can freely download them. And certainly PubMed is a search engine which has very advanced, offers you very advanced tools and techniques to do your search. The other search engines, which include Scopus, Web of Science, are subscription-based search engines, but they are equally useful, and they offer almost the same services as offered by the PubMed. These are some of the other databases. As you can see, the Academic Search Premier, You will receive this presentation later on, you can access this link. It offers search engines which belong to multidisciplinary disciplines. Similarly, we have LexisNexis Academic. It has a collection of current news and updates. Similarly, ARIC is a repository of scholarly and practical education literature. Education Full Text is a scholarly educational literature resource. And lastly, Social Sciences Citation Index. So you can also explore these additional databases for conducting your search. Now, these were some of the databases and initial steps that you are required to do when you are conducting a literature review or when you are planning to carry out a literature review. So let's start by looking at why or when a literature review search becomes ineffective, what happens. So in my own experience, I have noticed that students who cite very less, the reason why their literature reviews search is ineffective is, number one, because their search is limited to a particular range of sources. As I have mentioned earlier, that there are a number of databases you can try and explore and approach or access those articles that are peer reviewed. But unfortunately, some of us only rely on the Google Scholar, and Google Scholar does not necessarily give you a citation of a journal article which is peer reviewed. Sometimes it also gives you links of the blogs or magazines, and therefore you need to be very conscious about which link you are following and whether that journal is authentic, peer reviewed, or if it is a predatory journal, then that citation will not be of any use. So that is one of the problems that we encounter. Also, that because of the information technology advancements, we now see that searching tools have become advanced as well. But some of us, they are still relying on the simple research techniques, and we are not actually exploring the technology and some of the options that it has. So therefore, our research obviously becomes confined. We rarely use advanced options such as Boolean operators or logic. We rarely use saved research and other alert systems. So I'm going to introduce some of these ineffective search policies that I have noticed, and perhaps talking about some of the other alternative techniques can guide you to make your search effective. So the first step in order to make your search for the literature review to be effective is to identify the keywords that are related to your topic. Now, keyword refers to any variable, any concept that is directly relevant to your research topic or a research question or maybe the research objective. In order to identify a keyword, you need to brainstorm about what could be the possible keywords that can be generated, and there's no limit to the keywords here. When you are beginning your search, identify as many keywords that could possibly be related to your research title. So for example, here if we are talking about impact of insulin resistance on obesity in young adults, so looking at this topic, it is quite clear that we are interested in three kind of variables: insulin resistance, obesity, and we are interested in looking at young adults. So these are the three keywords you can start with, but you should not limit yourself to these three keywords. You need to brainstorm, maybe you need to think over and over again, maybe you need to discuss with your supervisor or colleagues, or maybe you need to look into the literature to identify possible synonymous keywords that can be used along with these. So for example, if we talk about obesity, in literature you will find that the word obesity has also been used or referred in other works. For example, being overweight, are you interested in combining or using that term also in your search? Similarly, maybe some people have used the term clinical morbidity, clinically obese, or some of the other terms can be could have been used in the literature. So you have to think over and over again and try to find out all possible alternative words to the keyword that you have identified. Also, it is very important that you are mindful of how the terms are referred to in different countries. So the most famous example comes about when we are writing the when we are writing our text is related to the US version of the US version of the spellings versus the English England UK spellings. So you have to be very careful about which version of the spellings are you using. This is an example I have extracted from a source from the Sage publications, and the reference is given at the end. This example is taken from a research titled "The Influence of Women's Self-Perception on Career Advancement," and here you can see a number of search strategies has been adopted. The keywords that you can see that are quite obvious from this example are women, self-perception, career, and advancement. But other than this, some of the other search items that you can consider by thinking and spending a little bit more time about your keywords is that women could have been alternatively referred as females in the literature. So you might want to include female as well as women. Similarly, self-perception could have been used alternatively as in the context of self-esteem or self-confidence or self-understanding. So whether you want to include these alternative keywords also in your search, that you might want to think about. Similarly, synonym words for career could be profession, vacation, work, or employment. And for the advancement, you could come up with some other alternative words such as progress, promotion, and success. The spelling differences, you can see that the word organization often is quoted as with S or with Z, so there is often a confusion about it. Similarly, there are confusion around singular or plural forms. For example, woman with an A, woman with an E, company with a company as a singular and companies as a plural. Similarly, terminologies variations would be found in the literature. For example, corporations are used is a word that is used synonymous with businesses and companies. So these are examples of how you can identify the key terms and how you can produce alternative keywords and expand your pool of key terms or keywords that you will use in those databases that I have talked about. I will now show you the two databases here that I have talked about, PubMed Central, and then I'll continue with the and I hope I'm being heard at this point, because there is utter silence over here. This is the website, and some of you who have their laptops and they want to follow it along, they can open this website. It's called pubmed.ncbi.nlm.nih.gov, and this is the advanced search builder option that I have showed you. Normally, I think if you go to this website. This is the first screen that you will see, pubmed.gov.org. Normally, if you would carry out a research, for example, as I have given you example of insulin resistance and obesity among young adults. So this is a primary search or maybe a simple search that I'm conducting. Once you click on the search option, it will take you to all the hits that it will probably have based on the topic command that we have given. As you can see that I have written the entire phrase or maybe the entire topic of my article that I have in mind. What you can see over here is that there are approximately 372 results with this command that I have given. It also is asking me whether I want to, this is the correct terminology that I need to have, but I'm just going to ignore. It has highlighted the words that I have that it has found which match with the topic that I have. For example, adults and insulin separately. The first reference is very close to the topic. Apparently, according to the search engine, it says effect of low fat versus low carbohydrate diet on 12-month weight loss in overweight adults and the association with genotype pattern or insulin secretion. The DIETFITS randomized controlled trial. And I think ultimately, if this is the kind of output you receive after putting the entire research topic, it should make you think that maybe I need to refine what I have written over here in this particular section, because insulin resistance, I am interested in looking at the relationship between insulin resistance and the obesity in the young adult population. And although it has filtered out young adult population, maybe I can play with these words so that I can find out articles that are close to what I'm looking at. If you look at the left side of the screen, you will find out some more features. You can refine your search by checking out these checkboxes. You can select articles with abstract only. Maybe you want to see the abstracts with free full text only, or just full text only. Similarly, if you go down, you will find out additional features that PubMed offers. You can look at identify the these kind of article types as well. For example, books or documents, clinical trials, meta-analysis, randomized controlled trials, reviews, or systematic literature review. Also, it gives you an option to select your articles according to the publication dates. And whether it is conducted on human or non-human subjects and all that. I have already made some sort of selection here. So you can see that English has been selected and humans have been selected. And I gave it a command that I am interested only in the female data. So it has extracted the data of the female. So this is just a snapshot of how PubMed looks like. And the second option that is most commonly used is Google Scholar as well. This is how it looks like. And Google also Scholar is, as I mentioned, is also very intuitive. It also offers a number of features. So you can also go and click on the advanced search option. And you can, as we have just generated a number of keywords just now, you can put all your keywords over here. You can put the entire exact phrase over here. Or maybe you can put one of the words here, and or you can search your articles according to the name of your author. So this way you can explore the advanced option to make your literature search more effective. Because we are running short of time, I'll be a little bit quick in exploring the other stages of searching. So we have so far looked into the search databases. Now I'm going to introduce some of the searching techniques that you can employ to make your search effective. Remember that we have learned how to identify the keywords and how to generate alternative keywords for our literature. The second step that you need to know is that now that you have a number of keywords, you need to learn how to combine those keywords or enter them in a way that you generate studies that show a certain relationship between those variables. As I mentioned that I'm not dealing with insulin resistance and obesity separately, I need to find out a relationship between insulin resistance and obesity. So it means that I need to combine certain keywords to be able to see the kind of literature that I'm looking at. So there are a number of techniques that you can use to do that. This kind of search techniques are called advanced level techniques or expert level techniques. Boolean logic or Boolean operators is one of the techniques that can be used. Second technique is phrase searching or proximity operators. Thirdly, using truncators or wildcards, determining which fields to search, limiting searches, and keeping a record of your research. And we are going to follow them one by one. I'm not sure if you have heard about Boolean operators or Boolean, also called as Boolean logic, but it's not a, you know, difficult terminology to understand. If you, I don't know how many of you are coffee lovers, but I am. So whenever I go to a coffee place, I order a coffee. I don't just normally ask them to give me a coffee. I have to specify what kind of coffee do I need. So sometimes I need a coffee that comes with the sugar and milk, or sometimes I need to have a coffee which has sugar but no which has milk but no sugar. So this kind of principle applies to the Boolean logic as well. It comprises of certain commands that you can give to make your research exactly how the way you want it, or maybe to design the search according to the research questions that you might have. There are three Boolean operators commonly used in almost all of the databases. These are usually used in capital letters. The first one is OR, that is OR. Next is and the third one is NOT. OR is the Boolean operator which requires either or both of the keywords to be present in the document. So for example, as I mentioned earlier, that the woman can be used as a singular or a plural. If you want to include articles that mention both of these terminologies, and you want to include both of them, so you can place the word or in between these two words. And it's not only refers to two, you can have more than two keywords also. You just need to keep on mentioning the word or here. What will happen eventually is that you will have increased number of documents to be retrieved. So you will end up, maybe exploring 13,000 or 14,000 additional literature articles. But the benefit of using this Boolean operator is that you are not missing out any article just because that a different terminology is used. The second Boolean operator is called AND. It requires using both terms to be present. It's compulsory for both of the terms to be present. For example, you need women along with the word self-perception. The example that I gave you was insulin resistance and obesity. So I need articles that have insulin resistance and obesity present together. So in that situation, I need to place AND between these two keywords. What will happen is that if you use this operator, ultimately the number of search that you will get reduced. Because now you have made your search command a little bit advanced, and you have narrowed down your research, and therefore the output results will be limited in number. And thirdly, the Boolean logic is NOT. As the name suggests, we need to identify the kind of keywords that we specifically want to avoid. For example, the example I have been using, obesity and insulin resistance in young adults. So if I want to include the young children or older adults, I can put the term NOT and add all of those age brackets that I want to exclude. So it requires the term to be absent. For example, career, not vacation. These are two terms that are very much similar, but you don't want articles that mention vacation word. Again, it will reduce the quantity of documents. And and NOT are the Boolean operators which are not usually highly recommended. Particularly the NOT Boolean operator is not recommended to be used frequently. It is because there are chances that you will miss out some of the articles by eliminating them from including. This is a diagrammatic way of looking at the Boolean operators. As you can see that if you use OR operator, you are including your research strategy is expanding. If you are using AND Boolean operator, you are using specific amount of search. It is not as expanded as previously. And third one is not Boolean operator. And in the not Boolean operator, you are excluding some of the literature. Let's now go to the PubMed Central website and try applying these Boolean operators. And let's see what kind of result do we get out of this. So I'm going to click on the advanced option here. And as you can see that PubMed Central and as well as the other databases have this login option as well. Please do sign up to these login accounts and register yourself to these databases. That should be the first step you should do before you carry out any search. And it is because just like you have attended the Mendeley reference citation workshop, when you log into these databases, everything that you search in it will get tracked and saved, and it will save your time and it will help you to transfer all your search literature searches to the directly to the Mendeley as well. So therefore, don't forget to log in yourselves. Now on right side, you can see that there is an option by default called all fields, which means that it will look into the articles by author or by their date or by their editor. You can pick any of these, or you can just click on the all fields by default and it will just explore the articles as it is. So I'm not going to actually experiment with this right now. I'm going to apply the first Boolean operator here, which is called OR. So for instance, I am looking at, insulin resistance. I think I better stick to the example of insulin resistance. Or, and I need to find out actually what is an alternative word that can be used for insulin resistance. So I am just stating that if there are articles which mention insulin only, I can include them also. Or I am also writing diabetes. So I'm using these three words as equivalent and I'm giving this command here. So this is how I have used the Boolean operator of OR. If you click on the search option, you would notice that it has extracted the articles that include, the instruction that you have given already. So the first one includes the word insulin resistance, as well as diabetes mellitus. Second, reference that it has extracted includes insulin resistance, insulin separately, insulin resistance separately as well. So using this Boolean operator allows you to extract articles that include all of these variables. You can see that the results here are 9,87,000 and above even. So this is a huge amount of, database that you have to deal with initially. So this just corresponds to what I was mentioning earlier, that if you are using OR Boolean operator, it will extend your literature search. And those of you who are exploring the studies and want to learn more about their topics, they can apply this. Now I'm going to apply the AND feature. For example, I'm looking at insulin resistance or diabetes and young adults. So here I have added the AND feature also, which means that any of these could be present, but there has to be young adults in it. So let me see if this feature works. Okay, so I think maybe I don't have to paste the word AND here. Okay, it would have worked actually anyway, but let me search it now. Okay, so you can notice that with the using AND Boolean operator, the number of hits that we have received is comparatively very few. It is 4,000, barely 4,000 and above. So again, it has streamlined articles that include insulin resistance and diabetes and young adults, and probability that these all three words would be combinedly presented in any research article are very less. So this is another way of demonstrating a Boolean operator, which is AND. Now we are going to try the last Boolean operator, which is NOT. And please, if there is any question, please do drop it in the chat box, and we are going to address those in the question answer session. So I'm going to try the NOT here. Insulin resistance or diabetes, NOT. Okay. And young adults, NOT older adults. So I have specified that I don't want articles which are on older adults. Now let's see if our search streamlines the research query. Okay, so you can see that with this combination of OR and NOT, we have received 41,000 hits, still lower than the OR a Boolean operator. But so the first one includes the study that is based on, it is a meta-analysis, by the way, and it is a systematic literature review on exercise and insulin resistance type D, type 2 diabetes mellitus. It is a systematic literature review. Secondly, if you go forward, you will find that this study would be more useful because it has identified the young adults which you were interested in. So maybe you can click on this. You can select as many studies that apparently feel that they are relevant to you by applying these Boolean operators. You can see that there are further three additional features attached to it. And if you have logged in, you can avail these three features as well. So you can save these for later on use. You can email them to you, or you can send them, these databases to the citation manager. For example, if you are using your Zotero or Mendeley, then you can directly export these references to your databases. So this is a very interesting feature that is available in these search engines. Similarly, if you at this stage, if you saw a case mein literature review bhi aa raha hai, and I don't want to see the literature reviews, so you can still click on the systematic literature review, the other, if you're interested in the others and not on that, so you can perhaps look and click on the kind of articles that you are interested in. By mistake, I clicked on the clinical trials, so it has extracted or refined the articles by that type, and now there are 3,596. So this is an example of how you can use Boolean operator strategy to make your search a little bit narrowed down. The second skill that you can use to make your search for the literature effective is called phrase searching or proximity operators. Here I want to mention that sometimes when we are doing the literature or a thesis, we use the term phrase, some terms as they are in proverbs or phrases. So I'm sure if you have heard about glass ceiling is a proverb which has a specific meaning if we use it as a phrase. And if we do not use it as a phrase, it has a different context. Using phrase search means that you are going to put inverted commas with the term that you think is a phrase. For example, glass ceiling, I want the search engine to interpret it as a phrase. So you can see that the outputs are different in case if I put the inverted commas and if I don't put the inverted commas. So I'll read out the first example to you. As a phrase, it's interpreted as many women pursuing careers in management find themselves encountering a glass ceiling. So that is an example of identifying articles which have used glass ceiling as a phrase. And if I do not put inverted commas, it is going to treat them as two different words. So for example, a sign of prestige for managers was to be located in an executive office with a high ceiling and large expanses of glass windows with a view. I think I still do have a little bit time to show you if this is going to work. So I'm going to make use of the word glass ceiling with an inverted comma, and I'm going to explore what kind of, whether I can identify articles with this term as a phrase. So unfortunately, it has not filtered out any study, but I'm going to try it with the Google Scholar. Please do remember that these search engines sometimes do not have, these additional features with them. So you might want to try them with another. So as you can see, the glass ceiling effect, is there a glass ceiling in Sweden, shattering the glass ceiling, all of the articles that have used glass ceiling as a phrase have been extracted. So again, you can use this feature if you are dealing with certain phrases. Similarly, there is another search strategy called truncators and wildcards. PubMed does not have this facility of using truncators. Truncators or wildcards are used when you do not have any keyword in your mind. For example, if you have the word depression, and one of my students, for example, is working on online gaming. And she says that online gaming, jo hai uska alternative word mujhe nahi samajh mein aa raha. So in that situation, you can use this feature of truncators, which means that you need to put the symbol static at the end of the word that you are confused about. And the search engine is going to retrieve all possible, matches that are with that particular word. So for example, in this case, I have used static with the word depressed, and it has retrieved three words alongside. It's called depressed, depressive, and depression. If you use it on your own in your laptops, if you try experimenting with it, any word that you have in your mind, just put the word, the symbol static at the end of that word, and try to see what kind of results do you get. You will notice that most of the results are matching with the term that you are interested in using. So you can use truncators also if you do not have the keywords, alternative keywords with you. And wildcard is a term that is used when you are uncertain about spelling. As I have mentioned about organization, you can see that if there are confusion about the word S or Z, you can put the static word instead of that, word. Organization may O-R-G-A-N-I, static, A-T-I-O-N, and it is going to extract articles based on both of the, spellings, either Z or S. This is another feature that you can use. Another technique of making your search effective is deciding which fields you are going to use. This topic ko maine already explained kar diya hai. If you go to the PubMed, I'm talking and I'm referring to the all field section here. All field mein ye aapke jitne bhi additional features hain, jisme abstract, free, full text hai, ye sab aa jate hain, and you can explore these options. Additionally, if you if you have any inclusion or exclusion criteria in your mind, so you can explore the all field options as well. I think it is in the advanced section here. Yes, here it is. All field ka ye matlab hai ki whether you want to search articles by author names or by the title of that study. So you can use all fields search in option to make your search a little bit effective. The next feature of making your search effective is called limiting searches and keeping a record. I will show you that abhi PubMed mein maine kuch jo hain wo search ki hain aapke samne, and it has generated history or logbook of all the search that I have conducted just now. इसके मुताबिक मैंने अभी तक तकरीबन 6 जो हैं वो searches जो हैं वो की हैं PubMed को use करते हुए. All of the information or all my activities have been stored, and this is also very useful. You can download it, store it, and the reason why you need this feature is because sometimes जब search करते हैं और हम कहते हैं कि okay I'm going to get back to this सर्च लेटर ऑन, और जब आप एक दो महीने बाद जो है वो उस चीज के बारे में भूल जाते हैं, देन यू रियलाइज ओ माय गॉड व्हाट वाज द स्टडी दैट आई वाज थिंकिंग अबाउट. सो हैविंग दिस काइंड ऑफ हिस्ट्री स्टोर्ड हेल्प्स यू अ लॉट, पर्टिकुलरली व्हेन यू आर डीलिंग विद अ ह्यूज अमाउंट ऑफ डाटा. सो यू कैन लिमिट योर सर्च एंड यू कैन कीप अ रिकॉर्ड ऑफ योर स्टडीज बाय अवेलिंग दिस फीचर. हियर आई हैव शोन यू एग्जाम्पल ऑफ the example that I have been referring to throughout this slide, और इसमें जो है वो current date और उसमें आने वाली hits जो है वो सब उनका जिक्र है. And sometimes when people are writing their literature reviews, they do mention the what kind of keywords they have used. It depends on the nature of the literature review though. इन समरी द फर्स्ट सेक्शन जो जिसमें हमने फर्स्ट ऑब्जेक्टिव था हमारा टू लर्न व्हाट आर द सम ऑफ द सर्च स्ट्रेटजीज दैट वी कैन एम्प्लॉय टू मेक आवर सर्च इफेक्टिव वी हैव लर्न दैट देर आर सम ऑफ द एडिशनल फीचर्स दैट वी कैन एक्सप्लोर टू यू नो मेक आवर सर्च नॉट ओनली इफेक्टिव बट ऑल्सो मैनेज आवर टाइम विच वी स्पेंड ऑन द लिटरेचर यू नो एक्सट्रैक्शन प्रोसेस एंड यू नो बाई एम्प्लॉइंग ऑल ऑफ दीज टूल्स I'm sure it can save your time as well as it can organize all of the studies that you filter out for later use. Now, having said that, the second objective of my talk is related to developing a literature review matrix. The students who have joined us today, if they are working on their master's level thesis or undergraduate thesis, might not necessarily want to include review matrix. Although I ideally instruct my students, irrespective of whatever level of a degree program they are, to incorporate the literature review matrix. It's a very useful feature, and it helps to organize the literature that you have just searched. So we are going to explore this additional feature very quickly. And in the chat box, and perhaps Dr. Adila has also shared a template to your emails. And while I'm going through, you can also try it at the same time, or you can try it later on, this feature. So what is a literature review matrix? It's basically a simple spreadsheet. It can be made on an Excel. You can make it on a Word document, but it is a spreadsheet comprising of a number of rows and number of columns, just like a table. It comprises of certain themes that you extract out of your studies, and it helps you to organize. And later on, when you have to synthesize, Dr. Sadia is going to talk about the synthesis and writing skills of the literature. So you can use this table of matrix of the literature to guide towards that process as well. This is an example of how the template is going to look like, and as you can see that I have taken this template from Walden University, and I have cited the reference also. It is a template which is available for public use, and you can take example from this and you can generate your own table of matrix. Here you can see that there are 7 or 8 columns. First column refers to the author details or date of that, or you can write down the reference of that article in the first section. The themes that I have taken out for a particular article are theoretical or conceptual framework, a research question, methodology, analysis and results, conclusion, implication and implications for the future research, implication for practice. ये जो themes हैं ये हर article के ऊपर apply होंगी जो आप अपने literature review में include करेंगे. So it is very important for you to develop the themes with the consultation with your supervisor, or if you are working on your own, then it's up to you to identify what is the information that I'm interested in from a literature review or a research article. So I have, in order to save the time, taken an example in Excel. एक already filled जो है वो form है, as you can see. इसमें थोड़ी सी themes different हैं. The first जो table of matrix है उसमें I have placed the citation, so I have placed the reference of the article that I am referring to. Secondly, I have extracted the research question. So this article, which is by Abrami in 1994, is related to positive social interdependence. And I hope I can show you this article also, and yes, I can show you this article. When you are developing table of matrices of the literature, it is ideally a good thing that you are looking at the entire article on its own, but it is also sufficient to take the information only from the abstract. So the article goes like, iska jo topic hai wo hai positive social interdependence and classroom climate. And it has been published in 1994. It's a very old research article. I don't have access to its full length article, so I'm going to read the abstract here with you. Abstract goes like, we explored the relationship between student perceptions of social interdependence and social support, attitudinal responses to the classroom life instrument developed by these authors were gathered in Canada from 4 classes totaling 123 8th grade students learning geometry in cooperative groups. We extended previous findings by examining the relationship among the classroom climate variables, causal attributions and achievement, and explored the consistency among the four classroom climate studies using statistical methods for meta-analysis to determine overall effect magnitude. And I'm very sorry, I have chosen a study that is very complicated, but I'll read out the end conclusion. Social support from the teacher and fellow students was moderately related to the perceptions of positive interdependence, but social interdependence factors were less important predictors. If you look at this abstract, you can have a general idea about what is the research question and what the author, theoretical framework of the author is. So if we look at the research matrix once again, I have given the citation here. And then the research question, research relationship between student perceptions and social interdependence and social support, what kind of theoretical approach has been adopted? So it is cooperative learning and classroom climate. What instruments were used? So this is the detail of the instruments. Independent variable was classroom climate and attributes. Dependent variable was two measures of student learning. Sample description is 123 students, 8th grade. Classrooms in Canada. Demographics that have been included were a race, gender, and age that have been extracted from the full-length article. This is finding of the analysis of this study. Hierarchical regression analysis, showed that the study. So meta-analysis was used, and weighing results were used for sample size. But then you have key findings section. यहाँ पे आप रिपोर्ट करते हैं कि इसकी मेन फाइंडिंग्स ये थी कि सोशल सपोर्ट फ्रॉम टीचर एंड पीयर वाज मॉडरेटली रिलेटेड एंड आई रेड इट आउट इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू फ्रॉम द एब्स्ट्रैक्ट एंड आखिर में आप ये जो नोट्स का सेक्शन है ये भी बहुत यूजफुल फीचर है इसमें आप अपने वर्ड्स में अपने जो इस आर्टिकल के बारे में जो व्यूज हैं वो एक्सट्रैक्ट करते हैं फॉर एग्जाम्पल इसमें मैंने लिखा है क्लासरूम लाइफ इंस्ट्रूमेंट 90 आइटम्स ऑन 16 एस्पेक्ट्स was used और इसमें आप ये additional जो notes हैं वो आप लिख सकते हैं regarding that article. Now the literature review matrix की बहुत सी types होती हैं and you can play with the themes that are written over here. आप इसमें कोई भी changes जो है वो ला सकते हैं but you have to be consistent about all of the studies that you are including in your literature review. They all have to be present in this literature review. Once it has been done, आप इसको import export कर सकते हैं, आप इसको save कर सकते हैं as let me show you. You can save it on your desktop, for example. As PDF. So I wanted to actually save it in the form of PDF. And you can use this feature on your Google Drives as well. I would encourage you to use Google Drives because usme aapko ye jo Excel ki file hai usko bar bar save nahi karna padta. Google Drive ka jo spreadsheet hai, it automatically saves the information. And when you are doing your literature, if you are making this matrix as well, so you don't have to keep on saving it. So as you can see that it has generated PDF for this as well. So it will, I think it has been downloaded and I'll have to extract it from here somewhere. Okay, so so anyways, this was just an example of very quickly showing ke aapki jo literature matrix hai, how does it operate? As I have stated earlier, ke jo literature matrix hai, it is basically a spreadsheet and you can create as many number of themes as you wish to create. Ultimately, aap isko import kar sakte hain aur apne literature review ka jo chapter hai, usme aap is table ko insert kar sakte hain and it is going to be very useful. When later on you will be synthesizing and Sadia Pini is going to talk about ki aap is literature ko synthesize kaise karenge. So this table is going to be very useful for you. With this, I'm going to end my PowerPoint and I hope that you have learned about the basic techniques that you can use to improve your literature search, as well as how you're going to design your literature matrix. I have given some additional links also that you can explore, and you will have access to these templates, which later on you can use, and you can always get back to me with, you know, more if you have any more questions about it. At the end, I would conclude by, you know, saying that there are four things that you must keep into the mind. The first one is that library databases are quite different from the web-based search engines. So when you are looking at the, you know, databases, do look into the library-based databases. They contain access to the authentic search engines that will be very useful for you later on. The other things that are very important to be kept into the mind is the information cycle determines where and when certain types of information are published. So always, always keep yourselves updated with the literature. The third important feature is that when you are working on searching your literature, always stay updated. If you have done your literature 2-3 months ago, the literature is being published very fastly. So you have to keep track on what are the literature that what kind of, you know, changes have been made in the literature. So I would now hand over the sort of, you know, session to Ms. Sadia Panni. And I would like to say again thanks to Dr. Adila Rahman for this wonderful opportunity to interact with the students. And hopefully we will have extended, you know, discussion on the same topic in the question answer session. So thank you very much once again. And over to Sadia Panni, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sajda Nas, for such a detailed presentation to officers for the research. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes,
I can.
I'm sorry, but I can't hear you clearly. Is my voice clear now?
Yes, Sadia, I can hear you clearly, but I don't know about the rest of the
people here. Yes, we can.
Okay. So I'm
carry on,
going
Sadia.
So now that we have talked extensively about how to search for data, we are going to talk about how to put it on paper, what to put on paper in the name of literature review, and what not to put there. So let's see. Let me know when you can see the presentation.
Yes, we can see now.
All right, good. So basically, this training workshop was on how to write a literature review, in which we talked about what is literature review and how to search for research literature. Right now, I'm going to hit on what is the process of writing literature review. And after myself, Ms. Nausheen will join us to talk about how to avoid plagiarism and what are the common mistakes that students make that increases their similarity index. So when we talk about the process of writing literature review, it is quite connected with searching for the literature review. However, I have, you know, conceptualized it under four P's of literature review. This is how I see it, and this is how I prepare for it. So when we talk about these four P's, these are plan, process, peer review, and plagiarism. And although they are all interconnected, I have written them in an order, because first we are going to determine what to write, in which we are going to talk about the scope and pre-review, which I'm going to discuss in detail. What do I mean by that? We are going to talk about how to introduce our literature review, how to outline it. In the process, we are going to discuss how to write. This is the basic problem area of the students, especially because when they are hit upon a jackpot of research literature, they think all that literature which carries those key terms is important to the research, and they try to add it, and they lose sight of the organization of thought. So the writing process and the skill of writing is the crux of the matter here. Then we will talk about the peer review. Normally you hear this word for publication purposes, but I'm using this term in a specific way here, in which we are going to see how to analyze and review the research, without which your literature review is incomplete. and how you build and argue your case for further investigation or exploration. And then we're going to talk about the how to avoid plagiarism through the writing process itself. So when we talk about the scope of literature review, as I mentioned earlier, the major problem that students have is that whatever literature they find on the key terms, they include it in their literature review without focusing on the variables, the methodologies, and the aspects that define the breadth and depth of your research. For example, at bachelor's and master's level, we give you a leeway to get away with a literature review spanning, let's say, 10 to 15 pages, in which you are sometimes throwing research ideas of previous researchers. And it lacks the focus. It does not have a coherent thread throughout the discussion. It lacks organization. And that is why we are actually doing this training session, so that you can refine the focus of your literature review itself, the size of your research. And you can define the breadth and depth of your research. So I'm going to, in the process of this training, going to show you literature review and how and where to see for things where you will be defining the focus, where the writers are going to preview the researchers, where they're introducing and outlining the stuff. So let's go next, what to write. So first of all, you need to introduce researches previously conducted in your area by mentioning what were their findings and what were their recommendations or suggestions. Because the purpose, as we have discussed earlier, is to find out which methodologies and skills were used by previous researchers and how their findings make room for your further investigation. Do they actually lead up to your further investigation in the first place or not? Because as students, as novice researchers, we fail to sometimes find and then link the connections between the previous researchers and our research. This is a very crucial aspect of literature review, which you have to maintain. Then the next is the main text should be in your own clear logical headings, in your own voice, and others' research data are only provided to support your own claims and ideas or to define your study. For example, what students mostly do is, and I'm going to show it in the future as well, that they take whole paragraphs or some sentences out of the literature review of other researchers, and then they cite their references as well, which becomes tertiary sources for them. And they have no connected thought, idea, or conversation going on to reflect what is the claim or idea of the researcher, which is you as a student, yourself. So what happens is that there are, what we see is paragraphs of research, even if it is related to your idea, even if it is focused, it lacks your own voice. So that is the thread of the, you know, pearls that we knit through in order to make it our research. Otherwise, it's just an assorted research, not even a review of that, a picture of that. Then you have to give credit where it's due. You have to make sure to cite in-text references with all claims that you make here. Once you're making the claim, for example, sometimes we make very tall claims that if this is done, that happens, without citing that, where did we learn that? Who said that? If there is a research, cite it to prove your point. So then check the references section for citations. This is the first thing that reviewers check. That if first number, that have you cited the resources, and number two, are the references provided at the end or not? So they go hand in hand. Then in the closing paragraph, you write about the literature review, which tells you how you are using it for designing your study. This is mostly absent in the literature reviews that we receive in the earlier stages of that. So what do I mean by preview? So those students who know about writing skills would know that we pre-read, and then we read during that, and then we read afterwards. So it is borrowed, the concept is borrowed from there, that first you define and select the searches that are relevant to your variables and population. And I'm going to discuss further as well, how can you do that? Another aspect that I tell my students is that, because I know most of them don't make matrices, especially at bachelor's and master's level, and they claim that they don't have enough time for that. So I tell them that once you have color-coded the portions of research, the methodologies, the variables, their finding suggestions that you need to incorporate in your research, after that, you outline, according to the different colors, their similarities, differences, what you're going to write about, basically. It makes things far easier for you to spot these things instead of looking for them again and again and reading them again and again. So this should be done, especially in PDF documents as well, the research articles that you find online. And then the best solution is make the matrices. So Dale Carnegie once said that tell the audience what you are going to say in writing the report, and then say it. First, you are going to introduce what you're going to say, and then you're going to say it. And that doesn't stop the story. Then you have to tell them what you have said. So if I translate it for your lit review or for a research report, I would say that say what you're going to say next. आप आगे क्या कहने लगे हैं वो आप पहले बताते हैं. Then say how you're going to say it. उसकी sequence organization क्या होगी यहाँ पे. Then you actually say that. And then say what you just said. आप आगे reconnect करते हैं उस idea को. हमने पहले क्या बात की और हम आगे क्या करने लगे हैं. Exactly फिर वो cycle repeat होता चला जाता है. तो जब आप आउटलाइन बनाते हैं, हम अपने स्टूडेंट्स को भी कहते हैं कि आउटलाइन पहले बनाएं, क्योंकि अगर आप आउटलाइन नहीं बनाएंगे और आप कॉपी पेस्टिंग शुरू कर देते हैं ऑटोमेटिकली बाय डिफॉल्ट, आपको जैसे ही ट्रेजर ऑफ रिसर्च मिलता है आपका दिल चाहता है कि बस ये डाल दें लिटरेचर रिव्यू में. सो प्लीज डोंट डू दैट, वरना आपकी बाद में ऑर्गेनाइजेशन कभी भी नहीं आ सकती है. इट टेक्स डेज टू डू दैट. सो अगर आप शुरू में आउटलाइन बनाएंगे, व्हाट विल हैपन इज इट विल गिव यू a picture of what you're looking for. It will help you in refining and synthesizing the research that you're going to select as well. So outline jo hai aap pehle se banayenge. Of course, if you have read the research beforehand, it gives you an idea ki isme kya variables hain, isme kin cheezon ke points aate hain, kaun si themes banti hain, kaun si sub themes banti hain. Lekin aapne ye nahi karna ki pehle se lit review likhna shuru kar de baad mein organization ki taraf jaye. First outline banaye, uska bhi do steps hain. That आप पहले लिस्ट करें पॉइंट्स को जो आपने रिव्यू करने हैं उस फिनोमेना के बेस पे और जो प्रीवियस रिसर्च में फाइंड हो रहे हैं, और फिर आप उनको हेडिंग्स और सब हेडिंग्स में फर्दर क्लासिफाई करें. फिर आप उन और उसके ऑर्डर को, लॉजिकल ऑर्डर को ऑर्गेनाइज करें. सो वाइल यू आर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग योर डेटा लिटरेचर रिव्यू, आप उसमें दो तीन ऑर्डर सेट कर सकते हैं. क्रोनोलॉजिकल हो सकता है कि वो टाइमली जब जब रिसर्च हुई, हम लोग नॉर्मली कहते हैं लेटेस्ट रिसर्च सबसे पहले लिखें, उसके बाद पुरानी रिसर्चेस लिखें. लेकिन अगर कोई बहुत मॉन्यूमेंटल रिसर्च है तो आप थियोरेटिकल फ्रेमवर्क से रिलेटेड है वो आप पहले लिख देते हैं. फिर थीमेटिक है, जो हम थीम्स बनाते हैं, सब थीम्स बनाते हैं, उस बेसिस पे आप अपने लिटरेचर रिव्यू को ऑर्गेनाइज कर सकते हैं. फिर इसी तरह से मेथोडोलॉजी, जो बेस्ड रिसर्च होती है कि क्या क्या यूज है, आप उस बेसिस पे भी ऑर्गेनाइज कर सकते हैं. After making your outline and organizing it, you fill the outline by adding your review of previous research. I've not written you fill the outline by adding previous research. I've written that you have to add your review of previous research and relevant themes and sub-themes with citations. We're going to discuss wo kaise hoga. So jab hum kehte hain process ki baat karte hain, what is the process of writing and how to write, to hum baat karte hain types of literature review ki. उसमें डिफरेंट स्टाइल्स हैं, आर्ग्यूमेंटेटिव है, हिस्टोरिकल रिव्यूज हैं, सिस्टमैटिक हैं, जिसका आपको डॉक्टर साजिदा ने भी बताया था, मेथोडोलॉजिकल हैं, थ्योरेटिकल रिव्यूज हैं. हम उनके भी डिटेल में फिलहाल नहीं जाएंगे, बिकॉज ईच वन ऑफ देम रिक्वायर्स डिफरेंट सेट ऑफ स्ट्रेटजीज. हम एक बेसिक कोर सेट ऑफ स्ट्रेटजीज पे जाएंगे जो आपको स्ट्रक्चर से एविडेंट होगा. सिमिलरली आप स्टाइल्स ऑफ राइटिंग, डिफरेंट आपके राइटिंग एक्सप्रेशंस होते हैं, वो डेफिनेटली आपके टाइप्स ऑफ लिटरेचर रिव्यूज से गाइडेड होते हैं. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इफ यू आर राइटिंग एन आर्ग्यूमेंटेटिव लिटरेचर रिव्यू, जिसको आप प्रेजेंट कर रहे हैं या कहीं पे आप उसको पब्लिश कर रहे हैं, तो उसका स्टाइल ऑफ राइटिंग आर्ग्यूमेंटेटिव बेस्ड होगा, ना कि डिस्क्रिप्टिव होगा. सो ये चीजें हमें थोड़ी सी देखनी पड़ती हैं. सिमिलरली हमें कोटिंग का बहुत शौक है, विद कोटेशन मार्क्स एज वेल एज विदाउट कोटेशन मार्क्स. एंड पैराफ्रेजिंग में हम महान हैं, विच आई शो यू हाउ डू वी पैराफ्रेज इन पाकिस्तानी एंड साउथ एशियन कॉन्टेक्स्ट्स. और उसके लिए हम गूगल ट्रांसलेट का भी सहारा ले रहे हैं, जो कि बहुत गलत बात है. फिर जो पैराफ्रेज करें या कोट करें, इनटेक्स्ट साइटेशंस मस्ट है देना. क्रिटिकली रिव्यूइंग रिसर्च, इसका मैंने पहले भी बताया, इसके बगैर आपकी वॉइस मिसिंग है, आपकी ओपिनियन, आपकी सेव मिसिंग है उस रिसर्च के बारे में. और जब आप स्टूडेंट होते हैं, आई अंडरस्टैंड कि आपका एक फियर होता है कि मेरी जो परसेप्शन है रिसर्च और नॉवेल रिसर्चर वो शायद ठीक नहीं होगी, बट दीज आर द एरियाज विच यू शुड डिस्कस विद योर सुपरवाइजर टू बिल्ड कॉन्फिडेंस इन योर सेल्फ के क्या है हम कह सकते हैं, क्या इसको कहने के लिए हम लॉजिकल आर्ग्यूमेंट्स दे सकते हैं, तो कैसे दे सकते हैं. सो दे विल हेल्प यू इन दैट प्रोसेस, जिसके थ्रू आप फिर बिल्ड करते हो अपना केस फॉर योर रिसर्च के मेरी रिसर्च क्यों जरूरी है फर्दर एक्सप्लोरेशन और इन्वेस्टिगेशन के लिए. And then you summarize the major research findings and link them to your study in the end as well. अब आपका structure क्या होगा literature review का? First of all, आप overview देते हो subject का, issue का. इसमें मैं point out करूँगी कि हमारे यहाँ पहले ये होता रहा है, हो कब ना होता. For example, I'm from education department, मैं वहाँ से example देती हूँ. जब हम students थे तो हमारे start होता था introduction देना, literature review का introduction जो है. It used to start from what is the meaning of education, और फिर उसके बाद हम अपने अपने असल टॉपिक की तरफ एक दो सफ़ों के बाद आते थे. सो आजकल दैट ट्रेंड हैज डाइड. आपने हिट करना होता है, हिट द नेल, ठीक है. आपने जो टॉपिक है जो उसका आपने वेरिएबल्स ऑफ फिनोमेना को स्टडी कर रहे हैं उसको डायरेक्टली लेना होता है और उसको बताना होता है कि मैं आगे क्या डिस्क्राइब करने लगा हूँ, किस चीज़ पे इसको हाईलाइट करने लगा हूँ. और दैट इज क्वाइट एक्सेप्टेबल एंड एनकरेज थ्रू आउट British writing systems and American as well. So, फिर आप जो थियोरी कंसिडर कर रहे हैं, आप अपने लिटरेचर के जो ऑब्जेक्टिव्स हैं वो आप शुरू में ही बताना शुरू कर देते हैं. आप उसके बाद अपनी रिसर्च को सिंथेसाइज करते हैं बाई सेगमेंटिंग द रिसर्च वर्क्स अंडर रिव्यू इनटू थीम्स और कैटेगरीज. इसमें आपने एक और चीज़ का जो ख्याल रखना होता है वो क्या है कि रिसर्चर्स सपोर्ट अ पर्टिकुलर पोजिशन, एक व्यू पॉइंट जो लेके आ रही हैं. हम लोगों का अक्सर इतना वाइड स्कोप नहीं होता रीडिंग का, रिसर्च का, कि हमें समझ आए कि जिस तरह की आपके जहन में एक एजेंडा होता है कि मैंने ये प्रूव करना है, लेट्स से आपको वो मिसगाइड कर देता है कि आप उसी टाइप की रिसर्च को पिक कर लेते हैं. सो डोंट फॉल फॉर दैट. आप दोनों ओपिनियंस लें, कुछ स्टूडेंट्स घबरा जाते हैं कि मैम ये तो उस पॉइंट को गलत प्रूव कर रही हैं रिसर्चेस, तो मेरा तो रिसर्च नहीं हो सकेगा. सो आपका काम ये नहीं है कि किसी व्यू पॉइंट को लेके इस सेंस में चलें कि मैंने उसी को प्रूव करना है. आपको नहीं पता कि आगे वो प्रूव होगी या डिसप्रूव होगी. सो आपने दोनों व्यू पॉइंट्स की रिसर्चेस ढूंढनी है, उनको प्रेजेंट करना है. दिस इज द एथिक ऑफ डूइंग लिटरेचर रिव्यू, कि आपने उसको एथिकली ऑब्जेक्टिवली जो है जो रिसर्च हुई है उसको उसी तरह प्रेजेंट करना है. कुछ बच्चे जो है लिटरली आफ्टर रीचिंग दैट रिसर्च एज वेल उसको हटा लेते हैं कि ये नहीं हमने मेंशन करना क्योंकि ये हमारे पॉइंट के खिलाफ जा रहा है. नहीं, आपने वो मेंशन करना होता है अपने लिटरेचर रिव्यू में भी और डिस्कशन और एनालिसिस के सेक्शन में भी. We give an explanation of how each work is similar to and how it varies from the others, to build your case for further investigation, exploration, and conclude as to which researchers are considered best in their argument. इसमें भी थोड़ा experience चाहिए होता है, वो आपको तब आता है जब आप देखते हो कि कितनी researchers ने इस study को cite किया हुआ है, और आगे हम थोड़ा सा detail में इसको पढ़ेंगे, और आपको उससे confidence आता है कि अच्छा इसके जो views हैं वो convincing hai, logical hai, and this study has made a major contribution in the development of that research. Aur wo definitely aapki assumptions ko phir lead karti hai. Isme aapne evidence use karni hai, iska kaam hi ye literature review ka, ki aapke paas research evidence le kya hai, ki aapke jo claims or assumptions hain aur hypotheses hain uske bare mein research ki evidence kya kehti hai. Aur definitely wo aap phir cite bhi karte hain. आपने उसके लिए करना है, सारी चीज़ें नहीं लेके आनी है, तो आपने सिलेक्टिव होना है. इसके लिए एक और प्रोसेस जो हम यूज़ करते हैं कि हम अपना वेरिएबल्स और अपना टॉपिक एक नोट पे लिख के सामने लगा देते हैं ताकि हमें याद रहे कि ये रिसर्च हमारे टॉपिक और हमारे जो रिसर्च क्वेश्चन है उससे मैच कर रही है, कंसर्न है कि नहीं. क्योंकि आपको बहुत रिसर्च मिलेगी जो ब्रॉडर एरिया से ताल्लुक रखती है लेकिन असल में आपकी स्टडी से बिल्कुल ताल्लुक नहीं है उसका. सो आप उसको सिलेक्ट करें, रिलेट करें अपने रिसर्च प्रॉब्लम से, उसको बताएं कि वो थीमेटिकली मतलब लॉजिकली क्रोनोलॉजिकली जिस भी आप उसको बताना चाहते हैं किस तरह से आप उसको रिलेट करना चाहते हैं, और आप ये मेंशन करेंगे कि मैं इसको इस एंगल से रिलेट कर रही हूँ. और फिर आप एडिशनल जो है इंफॉर्मेशन दे सकते हैं जो कि आपकी आपने नहीं इंक्लूड किया. आप ये भी मेंशन कर सकते हैं हमें ऐसी इस टाइप की भी रिसर्च मिली लेकिन दैट वॉज नॉट रेलिवेंट टू आर स्टडी सो वी डिड नॉट मेक इट पार्ट ऑफ इट. यूज कोड्स देंगे, इट मीन्स कि आपने यूज कम करने हैं. कोटेशंस ज्यादातर बच्चे जब हम उन्हें डराते हैं कि आपने रेफरेंसेस साइट नहीं किए हुए तो वो क्या करते हैं, भागते हैं और जाके अपने रिसर्च पे कोटेशंस डाल के आ जाते हैं. और वो आपको डॉक्टर मिस नौशीन भी बताएंगे कि वो उसका हशर क्या होता है फिर, चाहे आप क्वेश्चन मार्क्स डाल दें. तो इन एनी केस आपने जितना कम ऑपरेशनल डेफिनेशंस के लिए यूज करें, खुद टर्म्स को ऑपरेशनलाइज भी कर सकते हैं बाय द वे. और इसी तरह से जहाँ बहुत जरूरी है, जहाँ पे आप किसी चीज के हमारे बच्चों का मसला है कि वो अपनी अंग्रेजी के मसले में इतने फंसे हुए हैं कि उन्हें लगता है कि हम तो इतना अच्छा लिख नहीं सकेंगे, सो वाई नॉट पिक द स्टफ दैट इज ऑलरेडी अवेलेबल ऑनलाइन. और वहीं पे हम मारे जाते हैं क्योंकि हम लोग प्लेजरिज्म को इनकॉर्पोरेट कर लेते हैं अपनी रिसर्च में इंस्टेड ऑफ स्टेइंग अवे फ्रॉम इट और अवॉइडिंग इट. सो यहाँ से हमारी स्टार्ट हो जाती है प्लेजरिज्म ऐड होना, जहाँ से हम लिखना शुरू करते हैं प्रोसेस का. ठीक है, सो प्लीज बी माइंडफुल ऑफ दैट. और मैं अपने स्टूडेंट्स को ये भी कहती हूँ कि एक सेपरेट डॉक्यूमेंट वर्ड का बना लें, जिसके अंदर वो तमाम आर्टिकल्स को बार बार पढ़ने के बजाय उनके रेफरेंस के साथ, उनके यूआरएल्स के साथ, उनकी जो हाईलाइटेड पोर्शन से सिर्फ वो कॉपी पेस्ट फिलहाल कर लें और उसको सरप्लस लिटरेचर रिव्यू कह दें. अब उसमें से वो चंक करके पिक करें. मेटोसिस का भी यही काम है, वो भी यही काम एक टेबल के फॉर्मेट में कर रहा होता है. इसमें आप क्या करते हो, वर्ड डॉक्यूमेंट के ऊपर आप कलर कोडिंग आराम से करके और उसको फिर पैराफ्रेज कर सकते हो. सो पैराफ्रेजिंग का भी मैं आपको आगे बताऊंगी कि कैसे आप करें और कैसे ना करें. When it comes to summarizing and synthesizes, आपने synthesis में जो है अपने sources को एक paragraph में आपने करना है. जैसे जैसे आप review कर रहे हैं, आपने for example आप first paragraph लिखते हैं, second paragraph लिखते हैं, उनके दरमियान linkage ही आपकी उन sentences के through होती है जो मैं आपको थोड़ी देर में show करने लगी हूँ, कि वो आपके thought को build करते हैं, thread को link करते हैं आपके pearls of wisdom and research के साथ. Recapitulate means we assemble things, revise or summarize the things, important features of a research study, and then rephrase the study significance and relate it to your own work. Keep your own voice. Isko main jitna emphasize karu utna kam hai, because this is mostly missing. As novice researchers, hume dar lagta hai ki if we, first of all, we don't even know what is our opinion or voice about this thing. What do we think about this thing? Then we can you know write about it. So aap ye cheezein discuss karo jo aapke, kyunki you are the expert in your particular area. Even your supervisor, who is probably in your mind a better expert, would not know as much as you have read into that research. So you need to actually tell them that this is what I've read, this is the counter argument that they have presented, or this is another study which does not fall, just presenting an opposing view, let's say. So how am I going to review it, what I'm going to write? Discuss these things and ask these questions. A good researcher is one who asks the right questions. Okay? And when you are paraphrasing, use caution, because this is not your own and you have to cite it, you have to give your opinions accurately in your own words. Aur aapne unke words ko jo hai apna nahi bana lena. Aur main isme students ko aksar kehti hu ki aapne research aaj publish ki aur aapki study ko aap hi ke future jo students aa rahe hain jab wo copy karenge to aapko kaisa lagega. To jab personal baat aati hai na to students ko realize hota hai ki acha theek hai, if I would like to take credit for my work, wo bada banda uske liye possessive feel करता है. So उनको एहसास होता है क्योंकि I should give credit to the original sources as well. So sometimes we have to tap into the affective side of learning as well. So ये कुछ examples हैं जो मैंने आपके लिए बनाई हैं. जो normally बच्चे हमारे paraphrase करते हैं text को, वो कुछ इस तरह से है. ये original text है जो मैं article आपको दिखाऊंगी, वहीं से borrow किया गया है और उसको जो है students यूं paraphrase करते हैं. I hope it is visible to all of you. अब आप note करें, this study was actually on the effects of illness on your attitudes and how it affects the family life. Aur usme ek baat ye kahi gayi thi ki ek research hai jisne show kiya ki wives that are depressed are more likely to make an aggressive comment to their husbands than wives that are not depressed were, and depressed wives have less positive discussions than their counterparts. Isme do points bataye gaye. The researchers opine that these aggressive statements would likely become a stressor for the marriage. ये इन्होंने प्रूव नहीं किया अभी, लेकिन ये ओपिनियन दे रहे हैं उसके ऊपर, तो ये इनकी वॉइस है. और प्रोड्यूस अ नेगेटिव स्कीमाटा ऑफ मैरिज फॉर चिल्ड्रन और एडोलेसेंस इन द फैमिली. अब अक्सर बच्चे क्या करते हैं कि वो इतनी अच्छी अंग्रेजी जब देखते हैं, इतनी अच्छी तरह वो उसने निट किया अपने थॉट को, तो वो उसको यूं पैराफ्रेज करते हैं. हमारे बच्चे दे जस्ट फॉल इन लव विद दिस अकॉर्डिंग टू दैट. So मैंने इसलिए लिखा यहाँ पे अकॉर्डिंग टू Schmaling एंड Jacobson wives that are depressed make an aggressive comment to their husbands more than wives who are not depressed. मैंने अपनी तरफ से बहुत अच्छा paraphrase किया था स्टूडेंट. And the aggressive comments of wives become a stressor for the marriage. और आगे मेरी अंग्रेजी फेल हो रही है तो मैं थोड़ा सा बोरो करना शुरू हो गई एंड प्रोड्यूस अ नेगेटिव स्कीमाटा ऑफ मैरिज फॉर चिल्ड्रन. सो हम जो गलती करते हैं, हम डिफरेंट टर्म्स जो आ रही होती हैं, टेक्नोलॉजिकल टर्मिनोलॉजी जो आती है, हम उसको जाके सर्च नहीं करते इसका मतलब क्या, उसको समझते नहीं है. हम प्रोपेंसिटी है हमारी कि हम ये वर्ड्स पिक कर लेते हैं और यहीं से टीचर्स को भी पता चल जाता है कि आपने कितना कॉपी पेस्ट किया है और यहीं पे पिक कर लेते हैं आपके टर्निटन सॉफ्टवेयर वगैरह. सो अगर इसी चीज को हम यूं लिखें कि Schmaling एंड Jacobson एक्सप्लोर्ड, अब देखें लैंग्वेज कैसे डिफरेंट किया मैंने इसको, द इफेक्ट्स ऑफ डिप्रेशन अमंग वाइव्स कॉज्ड बाय मेंटल स्ट्रेस एंड डिस्कवर्ड दैट वाइव्स विद डिप्रेशन वुड हैव फ्यूअर पॉजिटिव कन्वर्सेशंस विद देयर हस्बैंड्स एंड वाइव्स हु वर नॉट डिप्रेस्ड. इट्स सेइंग द सेम थिंग बट इन अ टोटली डिफरेंट फैशन. दे ऑल्सो डिस्कवर्ड दैट डिप्रेस्ड वाइव्स आर प्रोन टू गेट वर्बली अग्रेसिव विद देयर लाइफ पार्टनर्स डिप्रेस्ड वाइव्स विच कुड पॉसिबली क्रिएट अ negative impression of marriage on children growing in those families. अब मैंने students की ही language में उसको describe करने की कोशिश की है and I'm assuming कि इस पे कम plagiarism के chances होंगे. अब हम बात करते हैं कि हम इतनी देर से कह रहे हैं in-text citations हो, citations लेके आए जिसको हम normally रवानी में references बोलते रहते हैं literature review के दौरान भी. So these are actually citations और आपके सामने कुछ examples हैं क्योंकि हमारे बच्चे बार बार लिखते हैं according to he or she said that. So usko jo hai minimize karne ke liye I am giving you some examples. Ye si study se hain, aapke samne do log hain who explored the effects of something. These people explained that. Ab yehi log ek dafa mention ho gaye aur in logon ko next time jab humne refer kiya to at all full stop and then giving that reference, they also noted that. Theek hai. And then several studies हम अक्सर जब summarize और synthesize करते हैं तो या हम larger claims करते हैं तो हमें जो है multiple researches का हवाला देना होता है. So यहाँ पे हम multiple research के इसका हवाला दे रहे हैं. I have given an example of verbs to use for in-text citations. I have highlighted don't use that or avoid using it as much as possible because I've seen कि जब हम इस रट में पड़ जाते हैं ना according to लिखना फिर हमें समझ नहीं आती इससे बाहर कैसे निकलना है. So tell your brain that not even to follow or go for that. यहाँ पे आपके सामने जो हैं कुछ जो missing नजर नहीं आ रहे वो मैं बोल देती हूँ, reviewed है और concluded है. Just have a look at these. You can take a snapshot of it as well. All right, so I use the term peer review the researches. What is that? You have to actually look for most cited researches. Jab kafi sare researchers ne kisi research ko review kiya hota hai, iska matlab hai ki unhone mention or cite kiya hua hota hai apni research mein, to iska humne ye matlab assume kiya hua hota hai ki iski validity hai, iski reliability hai is research ki, aur ye jo hai accepted ek jo hai study hai is field ke andar hai aur isko importance credence milti hai. So it helps you analyze the research quality as well. Kyunki hamare bacche jab Google Scholar pe ya Google pe jaake research khulte hain to unko mostly jo research mil rahi hoti hai wo itni highly cited, halanki usme ab aana shuru ho gaya ki kitni cite hui hai uske basis pe aap select karte ho, lekin phir bhi bahut achhi research aapke usse nikal jati hai. Plus abhi pichle dino hi somebody was discussing ki Indian research readily available hoti hai binisbat dusri research ke papers ke, to usse bhi hum log fir quality nahi dekhte. Unhone bhi secondary researches ki hoti hai, wahan se data borrow karna shuru kar dete hain. So go for the original and primary researches. फिर आप उसको जैसे हमने पहले बात किया क्लेम्स कर रहे हैं तो उसको उनकी assumptions को जो है अपनी assumptions को बिल्ड करने के लिए उन researchers को यूज करें. आपने हमें एक पैकेज ऑफ researchers नहीं देना, आपने अपनी थॉट का जिक्र करना है और उसके बाद आपने उस रिसर्च का हवाला देना है कि ये रिसर्च भी यही कहती है जो हम assume कर रहे हैं. इसमें आप उसके अंदर स्टडी में वेरिएबल्स उसके फैक्टर्स जो अफेक्ट कर रहे हैं उसको स्टडी करते हैं. ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट चीज है बिकॉज ये जब आप मिस कर देते हैं तो आपको पता ही नहीं चलता कि हम जो फैक्टर स्टडी कर रहे हैं लेट्स से क्या वो पिछली रिसर्चर्स ने उनको इम्पॉर्टेंट फैक्टर्स कंसिडर किया था या लेस इम्पॉर्टेंट फैक्टर्स में कंसिडर किया था. सो यू नीड टू नो कि व्हाट आर द मेजर फैक्टर्स दैट अफेक्ट और गेट अफेक्टेड बाय अ फिनोमेना. then mention the causations and correlations between variables identified. Critically review the previous research we have discussed. But then now I'm going to show you the examples, how you build up your case by knitting the thread of various ideas and how you build your own research voice as a narrator. So this is a study. Let me show you the title. Living with Chronic Illnesses. How are those with a chronic illness treated by their families since their diagnosis? अब मैंने जब as a reviewer मैं इसको study करूंगी, मैं abstract को देखूंगी, मैं उसके aims देखूंगी, मैं उसको बताऊंगी ये research क्यों important है और इसमें मुझे क्या analyze करने में और assess करने में मदद देगा, इन्होंने जो है हमारे participants क्या होंगे और मेरी जो रिंके क्या थे और इनकी जो ethnographic यानी कि methodology of study थी वो क्या थी, that is very important. और मैं अक्सर students को कहती हूँ अपने synopsis में भी abstract लिखा करें, because आपको पता चलना शुरू जाता है, आपका focus आना शुरू जाता है write up में कि मैं क्या कर रही हूँ और कैसे कर रही हूँ. So ये study क्यों essential है, ठीक है, और ये क्या explore करेगी, ये आपने जो पढ़ा था ना say what you're going to say and then say it, ये उससे भी linked है, ठीक है, और इस लिटरेचर रिव्यू से आपको और स्टडी से आपको क्या हेल्प होगा असेस करने में. आई एम हाईलाइटिंग दैट. सो वंस वी कम टू द लिटरेचर रिव्यू, एक और बात भी बिफोर आई गो ऑन, आप अपने इंट्रोडक्शन के लास्ट पैराग्राफ्स को अपने लिटरेचर के फर्स्ट पैराग्राफ से इस भी लिंक रखते हो, ये ना हो कि वो टोटल ऑपोजिट बातें हो रही हो. देयर हैज टू बी अ कॉमन थ्रेड, जिस तरह से आपके पैराग्राफ्स के दरमियान एक कॉमन थ्रेड होता है. सो यहाँ पे उन्होंने डायरेक्टली हिट किया उस बात को जिसके ऊपर इन्होंने रिसर्च करनी है और बताया कि मैं कैसे उसके ऊपर रिव्यू करूंगी. दैट आर सेपरेटली रिव्यूड हियर. व्हाई? बिकॉज ड्यू टू द ट्रेमेंडस डिफरेंसेस इन द टू एंड इन दिस स्टडी दे विल बी कंपेयर्ड अगेंस्ट वन अनदर. व्हाई? टू क्रॉस एनालाइज द डिफरेंसेस एंड सिमिलैरिटीज एंड हाउ द फैमिली मेंबर इज ट्रीटेड डिपेंडिंग अपॉन देयर टाइप ऑफ इलनेस एज वेल. तो इन्होंने दो में क्लासिफाई किया, फिलहाल क्रॉनिक फिजिकल इलनेस में और फिर मैरिज. दीज आर द थीम्स एंड सब थीम्स दैट वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट, कि आपने किस चीज को किसके अंडर करना है. और आप नोट कीजिएगा कि इनकी सब थीम्स जो है इनकी थीम्स के अंदर कॉमनैलिटी के थ्रू आएंगी, लाइक ऐसा नहीं है कि बहुत ही डिफरेंट जा रही है. दे आर कनेक्टेड विद ईच अदर, चाहे वो फिजिकल की बात करें इलनेस की या मेंटल इलनेस की बात करें. और फिर अगेन जब वो बात कर रहे हैं तो उन्होंने अपने इंट्रोडक्शन पहले दिया है, मैरिज के बारे में बताया है, मैरिटल बॉन्ड के बारे में बताया है कि वो क्यों इंपॉर्टेंट है, वो हिट होता है, नेगेटिवली इम्पैक्ट होता है जब फिजिकल इलनेस फैमिली में आ जाती है. और फिर वो कैसे बताएंगे कि डेली इंटरेक्शंस और कन्वर्सेशंस आपकी इसको अफेक्ट करती हैं. वो क्यों पढ़ना चाह रहे हैं, इस चीज को स्टडी करना चाहिए वो इसलिए, इट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट टू डिस्कस द कम्युनिकेशन दैट अकर्स अराउंड दीज इलनेसेस इन ऑर्डर टू अंडरस्टैंड हाउ दोज हु हैव वन have been treated since the diagnosis based on research already connected around similar communication processes. Ab jahan jahan ye baat karengi na, inki thread aage ye research ka hawala zarur dengi. Inhone jo claim kiya hai uske aage research ko likha hai ki ye baat ho rahi hai. Fir aage inhone dobara connect kiya hai ki jo ye literature present kar rahe hain, it proves that in a situation where a spouse is chronically ill, it is important to use communication to make one. अब ये इनकी अपनी voice है जो आपके link को link बनाती है आपके literature review के अंदर और ideas को knit करती है. ये सबसे important threads होते हैं जो जरूर देने हैं. फिर ये अगला claim जब करने लगे हैं तो फिर उससे पहले एक और point करेंगे. Talking about the state of the relationship can be helpful. और आगे उसको बता रहे हैं कि वो किस type की है आपकी रिलेशनशिप, कोलैबोरेटिव है, कम्युनिकेशन है उसमें. और फिर उसको दोबारा कनेक्ट करें. दिस शोज दैट इट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर मैरिड कपल्स टू टॉक अबाउट दिस सिचुएशन टुगेदर टू कीप द रिलेशनशिप स्ट्रॉन्ग सिंस दीस टैक्टिक्स हैव बीन प्रूवन थ्रू रिसर्च टू बी हेल्पफुल फॉर द कपल. सो लेट्स गो फॉरवर्ड. अब ये मेथड बता रहे हैं कि इस रिसर्च को जो इन्होंने कंडक्ट किया प्रीवियसली वो मोस्टली नैरेटिव स्टडीज थी और नैरेटिव बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है स्टडी के लिए क्योंकि हर फैमिली का अपना एक वो नैरेटिव हो सकता है. तो आपके लिए मुश्किल होगा कि आप अर्ली रिसर्चेस जब इस एरियाज में कर रहे हो तो आप एकदम क्वेश्चनर्स पे चले जाएं. सो अर्ली डेटा कलेक्ट करने के लिए भी हम लोग अक्सर जो है फील्ड बेस्ड जो है सोशल साइंसेस के अंदर नैरेटिव्स को फिनोमेना को स्टडी करने के लिए यूज करते हैं. अब यहाँ पे जब बात कर रहे हैं सेवरल स्टडीज की, तो सेवरल स्टडीज हमें कहाँ से आई, ये मेट्रिसेस से आता है। ये स्टूडेंट्स हमारे इसलिए नहीं लिख पाते क्योंकि उन्होंने मेट्रिसेस नहीं बनाई हुई होती है, या उन्होंने अलहदा से लिटरेचर रिव्यू को इकट्ठा नहीं किया हुआ होता है और कलर कोड नहीं किया हुआ होता जिससे उनको याद रहे कि कौन कौन सी रिसर्च स्टडी किस बात पे स्ट्रेस दे रही थी। तो यहाँ पे इन्होंने इसलिए दे आर एबल टू राइट क्योंकि यहाँ पे सिंथेसाइज कर रहे हैं एक तरह से अपनी रिसर्च को कि दे स्ट्रेस द इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ नैरेटिव फ्रॉम द, अब मैंने मेथोडोलॉजिकल बेसिस पे अगर सिंथेसाइज किया होगा अपना प्रीवियस रिसर्च का डेटा तो तब मैं यहाँ पे ये क्लेम आगे से कर सकती कि कौन कौन सी स्टडीज क्या क्या स्ट्रेस कर रही हैं। फिर ये अगर मेरी वॉइस आती है कि दे आर नैरेटिव्स आर बेनिफिशियल तो मैं फिर रिसर्च का सहारा लूंगी कि दोज विद अ क्रॉनिक फिजिकल इलनेस आर मोर लाइकली टू एक्टिवली शेयर इफ देयर फीलिंग्स एंड परसेप्शंस आर कंफर्मड बाय द पीपल स्पेशली, दैट इज द रीजन दैट नैरेटिव्स आर इंपॉर्टेंट टू बी टेकन। लेट्स गो फर्दर, यहाँ पे वही रेफरेंस साइटेशन का आ गया एट अल वाला और बात की है इन्होंने कि उन्होंने क्या मोशंस डिस्कस किए और क्या बात की है। और फिर नेक्स्ट मोस्ट ऑफ द स्ट्रगल्स, ये रिसर्चर की अपनी वॉइस है ग्रीन में कि मोस्ट ऑफ द स्ट्रगल्स दैट पेरेंट्स इन द स्टूडेंट फेस आर विद द टॉपिक। सो आप जो भी रिसर्च देंगे ना उससे पहले बताएंगे कि लिंक बिल्ड करेंगे कि अगली बात क्या होने वाली है, आप फिर रिसर्च को सपोर्ट करने के लिए अपने आर्ग्यूमेंट को यूज करेंगे और फिर उसको सिंथेसाइज करेंगे आखिर सेंटेंस में, इनकैप्सुलेट करेंगे अपने वर्ड्स में कि स्टडी से फाइंडिंग से आपको पता क्या चलता है, हाउ डज इट हेल्प योर स्टडी। ठीक है, अब यहाँ पे है देर इज लिटिल लिटरेचर इन रिगार्ड्स टू मेंटल हेल्थ इफेक्ट ऑन सेल्फ कॉन्सेप्ट्स एंड आइडेंटिटीज, इनके कुछ और वेरिएबल्स निकल के आए कि सेल्फ कॉन्सेप्ट्स और आइडेंटिटीज भी चेंज होती हैं, मॉर्फ होती हैं आपकी कॉन्वर्सेशन और आपकी बीमारी से, तो उस पर जब रिसर्च कम हुई हुई है तो वो भी हमने मेंशन किया है। हम टीचर को जाके नहीं कह देते कि हमें रिसर्च ही नहीं मिली इस चीज पे, हम लिखते हैं कि देर इज लिटिल लिटरेचर अवेलेबल इन दिस रिगार्ड, बट ये ऐसे नहीं लिख सकते कि रिसर्च हमें नहीं मिली तो इसलिए हम ये लिख दें, ये भी याद रखिएगा। यू हैव टू बी माइंडफुल कि आपने वाकई थरो उसकी रिसर्च की हुई है। ऑल राइट, और यहाँ पे अगेन आपने उसको समराइज किया है, this literature exemplifies that parental mental illness controls more channels of communication than a child or adolescent's mental illness does, and while much literature exists ab main dobara synthesize kar rahi hu about families and mental illness, unfortunately very few scholars focus on the talk that occurs about the family members with the illness and the communication around this topic. This is this researcher's voice. और फिर उसको एंड पे क्लोजिंग में रिव्यू करना कि ये जो है मेरे स्टडी से कैसे लिंक करता है कि रिव्यूइंग द लिटरेचर बैक लीड्स बैक टू द क्वेश्चन हाउ आर दोज विद द क्रॉनिक इलनेस ट्रीटेड बाय द फैमिली सिंस देयर डायग्नोसिस, एनालाइजिंग बोथ मेंटल एंड फिजिकल इलनेसेस इन द फैमिली कम्युनिकेशन प्रोसेसेस अराउंड देम आर एसेंशियल। अब ये मैं केस बिल्डअप कर रही हूँ अपनी रिसर्च का टू फर्दरिंग द कन्वर्सेशन दैट कम्युनिकेशन स्कॉलर्स आर क्रिएटिंग टू अंडरस्टैंड दीज यूनिक फैमिलीज, एंड दिस इज व्हाट दिस रिसर्च इज ऑल्सो अटेम्प्टिंग टू डू। अब मैंने इसमें बात की थी कि आपने प्रीवियस रिसर्च को कैसे वे करना है, एवेल्युएट करना है कि उसकी क्या कदर है, क्या वर्थ है लिटरेचर के अंदर। सो उसके लिए कुछ हमारे पास पॉइंट्स हैं जो कि मैं बहुत तेजी से आपको दिखाऊंगी बिकॉज़ वी आर शॉर्ट ऑफ टाइम। फर्स्ट इज प्रोविनेंस, ऑथर्स की क्रेडेंशियल्स क्या हैं, वो किसी यूनिवर्सिटी में है, किसी रिसर्च ऑर्गेनाइजेशन में है, उनके आर्ग्यूमेंट्स क्या है, उनका बैंक ऑफ रिसर्च पिछला क्या है, इम्पैक्ट फैक्टर्स के लिए चेक किए जाते हैं, फिर उनके डिफरेंट साइटेशंस जो उन्होंने डिफरेंट आर्टिकल्स में है वो आपको पता चल जाती हैं, मेथोडोलॉजी है कि उन्होंने कौन सी टेक्निक्स यूज की टू आइडेंटिफाई गैदर एंड एनालाइज द डेटा व्हिच वाज एप्रोप्रिएट फॉर एड्रेसिंग द रिसर्च प्रॉब्लम। आई हैव कम अक्रॉस सेवरल रिसर्चर्स दैट वर कलेक्टेड बाय माय स्टूडेंट्स जो कि उनका मेथड से हम एग्री नहीं कर रहे कि वो मेथड इनकैप्सुलेट नहीं कर पा रहा उस रिसर्च प्रॉब्लम को सही तरह से। सो आपने आई अपनी ओपन रखनी है, जरूरी नहीं है कि रिसर्च पब्लिश हो चुकी है या नेट पे अवेलेबल है तो वो बस ऑथेंटिक और क्रेडिबल रिसोर्स है, आपने उसको देखना है और आपने ये मेंशन भी कर सकते हैं कि हमारी जो ये रिसर्च है इसमें ये मेथड यूज किया गया था, जबकि एक बेहतर मेथड उसके लिए ये हो सकता है जो हम अपनी स्टडी में यूज कर रहे हैं। ऑब्जेक्टिविटी आपने बहुत ज्यादा इंश्योर करनी होती है, आप द ऑथर्स पर्सपेक्टिव जो है वो वेल बैलेंस्ड है, अगर इवन आपका कुछ एजेंडा होता है तो आपने वो अपने मेथडोलॉजी के चैप्टर्स में मेंशन करना होता है, आपका अपना रिसर्चर का एज अ पार्टिसिपेंट क्या है या आपका एज अ रिसर्चर क्या आपका व्यू पॉइंट है, ये जरूरी होता है मेंशन करना क्योंकि वो आपकी डिस्कशन एनालिसिस में रिस्क के निकल के आ रहा होता है और आपको फिर वो बायस की तरफ लेके जा रहा होता है, तो आपने पहले से रिसर्चर बायसेस को मेंशन करना होता है। फिर आपने कॉन्ट्ररी डेटा को भी जरूर कंसिडर करना होता है और उसको लॉजिकली आर्ग्यू करना होता है, अगेंस्ट जा रहा हो चाहे फेवर में जा रहा हो आपके। पर्सुएसिवनेस होनी चाहिए आपके राइटअप में कि आपने ऑथर्स के जो थीसिस दिए हैं वो कन्विंसिंग हैं, लॉजिकल हैं. वैल्यू, आर द ऑथर्स आर्ग्यूमेंट्स एंड कंक्लूजंस कन्विंसिंग? डज द वर्क अल्टीमेटली कंट्रीब्यूट इन अ सिग्निफिकेंट वे? और जब आप रिव्यू करते हो, दिस इज व्हाट यू आर एक्चुअली डूइंग, जिसकी आपको मैंने एग्जाम्पल दिखाई थी कि उनकी स्टडी का, उनका रिसर्च क्वेश्चन क्या था, what were they trying to discover, methodologies kya thi, samples, variables, theoretical frameworks, statistical analyses, findings kya thi unki, agar aap matrices bana le to bahut hi acha ho jata hai. Further questions ye zarur padha kare, ye aksar aapke abstract ke end pe ya aapke discussions or analysis ke end pe aur recommendations mein bhi ye mention kiye jate hain. Usse aapko bahut guide hota hai ki aapki research ka focus kya aapko lena chahiye, what is the further logical step to be taken in that area of research. Similarly, gaps in previous researches, आपने जरूर mention करने थे. ये चीजें आपको help करती हैं अपनी study को credible बनाने के लिए. If there are conflicting studies, why do you think that is the case? And इसमें एक और चीज जो ख्याल रखनी होती है कि was the research funded by a source that could influence the findings? For example, Dr. Sajda ने coffee की example दी, तो आपको net पे बहुत examples मिलती हैं, coffee is good for health and then coffee is bad for health. और आपको देखना पड़ता है ये research किसने की है. अगर ये coffee making जो इदारे हैं वो अगर funding देते हैं और करवाते हैं, तो जाहिर बात है वो coffee के health benefits पे ज्यादा गौर करेंगे. So please ये भी mention देखा कीजिए अगर आप depth में, खास तौर पे PhD level पे जब research करते हैं. So abstracts को carefully पढ़ें उसके लिए, और notes जो हैं वो जरूर maintain करें. आप matrices में भी कर सकते हैं, आप अगर word document पे बना रहे हैं तो आप comments section से जाके अपने अपने हर study के बारे में comments लिखें. That is very important because it helps you write an unplagiarized version of what you want to say. वो comments आपको help करते हैं, opinions आपकी और assumptions आपकी बनाते हैं, और वो बहुत फायदेमंद होते हैं. वहां पे आप उस वक्त कॉपी पेस्टिंग नहीं कर रहे होते हैं, उस वक्त आप वर्ड्स बोरो नहीं कर रहे होते हैं. सो आप अपने जब कमेंट्स देते हैं, इट हेल्प्स यू बिल्ड योर ओन आर्ग्यूमेंट्स एंड क्लेम्स. कॉमन मिस्टेक्स जो होती हैं, ये बहुत ज्यादा जो मैंने पर्पल में हाईलाइट किए, ज्यादा हमारे स्टूडेंट्स की लिटरेचर रिव्यूज में होती हैं कि सोर्सेज इन योर लिटरेचर रिव्यू डू नॉट क्लियरली रिलेट टू द रिसर्च प्रॉब्लम. और फिर आपने टाइम नहीं लिया होता है आइडेंटिफाई और डिफाइन करने के लिए रिसोर्सेज को जो आपकी रिसर्च प्रॉब्लम से रिलेटेड हैं, और आप बहुत ज्यादा सेकेंडरी सोर्सेज पे ड्वेल कर रहे होते हो. और प्राइमरी, अनफॉर्चुनेटली इन द पास्ट हमारे पास प्राइमरी की एक्सेस नहीं होती थी, बट अब बहुत से डेटा की एक्सेस होना शुरू हुई है. सो ऑलवेज डिग डीपर. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, आपको एक आर्टिकल मिला है, उसने किसी का थ्योरेटिकल फ्रेमवर्क यूज किया, गो फाइंड दैट रेफरेंस इन दैट रेफरेंस लिस्ट, वहां पे ओरिजिनल पे जाने की कोशिश करें. अनक्रिटिकली एक्सेप्टिंग इन अदर रिसर्च फाइंडिंग, क्योंकि वो पब्लिश हो गया है, सो हमने अनक्रिटिकली एक्सेप्ट कर लिया, विच इज अ रॉन्ग थिंग टू डू. एंड योर लिटरेचर रिव्यू डज नॉट डिस्क्राइब द सर्च प्रोसीजर्स, आपने कैसे इस रिसर्च लिटरेचर तक पहुंचे. और फिर रिपोर्ट्स नहीं कहता, आइसोलेटेड स्टैटिस्टिकल रिजल्ट्स rather than synthesizing them in chi-squid or meta-analytical methods. ये जो advanced researchers हैं, इनको इसका ज़्यादा पता होगा. Meta-analytical methods होते हैं जब आप research के जो different researches में हैं, उसका एक meta-analysis research का होता है, और in brief terms, and only includes research that validates assumptions that you already have and does not consider contrary findings and alternative interpretations around that literature. Now aapko main bata chuki hu ki aapne paraphrase kis tarah ke andaaz se karna hai, aapne less quote karna hai, review critically more karna hai, apni opinion zyada deni hai, build karni hai, in text citation deni hai likhte hue, aur references provide karne hain. Pe ab Ms. Naushreen aapko further batayengi ki kya problems and issues aate hain, unko kaise avoid kiya ja sakta hai. Thank you, over to Naushreen. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I am trying to share my screen. It will take a little time.
Ms. Nushin, if you have any problem to share,
Can you hear?
Let me know. I can. Yes, yes. Yes, we can hear you.
I think it's getting late for sharing the screen. If you can please share the screen, or let me try for once. Wait a minute. I think it's getting shared now. Just a minute, please. Is it visible?
No.
Now can you see the presentation?
No. Have you shared your screen?
No. Okay.
Did you click on present now?
Yes, I have shared.
Okay. Then again, double click on that screen.
Let me try again.
There is no issue. I can just show your presentation, yes, and you can just deliver.
I think you can share it because it's taking time from here. An error has occurred when sharing. This message I have received. Let me try for.
Can you see my screen? Your presentation? Ms. Machine, can you see my screen?
Yes, it's getting uploaded. No, Dr. Adila, it's not visible at the moment.
Okay.
Dr. Adila, it's visible to us.
Nushin, I think agar aap sign out karke dobara sign in kar le, maybe it will work then.
I think she's doing now. If any participant have any question from Dr. Sajda or Dr. Ms. Sadia Panne, you can ask. Or if you have any query, anything which you are not clear, in the meanwhile, you can just have a question answer session. Yes, Ms. Nushin.
I have rejoined in order to address the issue. I'm unable to share the screen right now. Dr. Leela, can you please share it again?
Okay, I'm doing that. So can you see my screen now? Can you see your presentation? Can you see my presentation now?
Can other people see the presentation?
Yes, we can.
I can't, but I'm asking other people.
Yes, I can see the screen also.
Okay. Then I started. Okay. So, Assalamualaikum. I'm Roshin, Master and Inspirator, Fatima Jinnah Valley University. I hope you have learned a lot from previous sessions regarding different techniques of literature writing. I will brief you further for how to write a plagiarism-free literature review, and we will talk more upon the usage of Turnitin software. We at QEC receives all theses and research papers by the scholar. In most of the documents, almost same kind of mistake.
Voice is not visible.
She's reconnecting.
Oh, yeah, she has a net problem. Can you please show it to the full screen?
वैसे नौशीन अगर अपने वॉइस के जरिए फोन पे अगर वो कर सकती हैं, मे बी वी कैन, शी माइट हैव एक्सेस टू दी स्लाइड्स ऑन हर फोन, अगर ये काम नहीं कर रहा, मे बी दैट वे वी कैन गो अहेड.
आई विल आस्क. अगर व्हाट्सएप पे आ सकते हैं तो व्हाट्सएप पे ले लेते हैं हम आपको.
हेलो, कैन यू हियर मी नाउ? आई एम sorry, internet is
Ajay Noshin, we can hear you.
Yes. Am I audible?
Yes.
Ajay Noshin, we can hear
you. Okay. So we receive all these things by the scholars in most of the documents. Please, Dr. Adila, you may share the screen.
Okay. Is it visible?
Thank you so much.
Can you see it, Noshin, now?
No. Okay. So,
can anyone
the researchers think that they have paraphrased the idea, so there is no need to cite actual researchers. However, this comes under plagiarism, and higher similarity index is just because of non-recognition of real work. So in order to avoid such situations, one must cite the original work from where it is extracted. As paraphrasing any particular idea is helpful by using different words. However, if you mix words and original work, then it needs to be cited citations. Can we move on to the next slide, please?
I have done with that.
Okay. Okay. So we have at Pasadena Women University done it in software, which is used to check the similarity with the existing work. Majorly, it shows the similarity from three sources. Those are the internet sources, publications, and student papers in cumulative. So in aggregate, the similarity index should be equal to or less than 19%. However, it should be less than 5% from single source. Please, next slide. Many people confuse this single source with the above mentioned sources. The single source is the one which is bifurcation of the above sources from internet sources. You may have similarity greater than 5, but when you break it down into small sources, it will be a summary of multiple sources. Here it is a 6% cumulative, which is bifurcated into three sources, 5% internet source, which doesn't matter at all because this will again break down into small sources. If we can move to the next slide, I can elaborate that. Can you see these small sources like 1% match, less than 1% match, and so on? So if this 1% match is written as 5% match, then the text. So this 5% cumulative is greater than 19%, and here you need to address all three sources, which are internet sources, publications, and the student papers. We can move on to the next slide. So what are the main problems once you have written with the thesis and you have completed your document? Usually the students get their thesis processed either themselves or by someone else out of institution. So earlier processing of thesis may or may not be a problem. So when it becomes a problem, because issues of earlier processing from outside the institution, and when it becomes a problem, at first hand I will advise not to process your thesis by yourself and not at all from somebody who is not from FJWU, because in that case there will be a very high risk that your work will be misused. We have number of cases in which students have experienced this, which caused unnecessary delay in their thesis processing, because QEC needs to verify earlier processing of thesis, either processed by student or a person outside the institution or by a supervisor. So there are also precedents in which earlier processing has been deleted. We can move to the next slide so that I can elaborate more. Because it has been processed before its submission to QEC, and the instructor has deleted the source. Here you can see that 98% similarity is shown by the earlier source, which was processed by somebody else. And when I dig out the source,
I think Ms. Nausheen has a severe connection problem. So, Ms. Sadia or Dr. Sarita, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, you just to further.
And perhaps we can.
We can describe.
Okay.
Nausheen is trying to highlight is that you need to carefully look at the percentage of the, you know, similarity index that has been shown, and if it is more than 5%, you need to rectify it. And she is also explaining that you should not blindly. Yeah, we have. Okay, so we have joined Nausheen, so you can confirm.
Yes. So basically, what I'm okay, we can move. To the previous slide, yes. So here we came to know that the instructor has deleted the earlier processing. Now the student is lost and stated that I have submitted a thesis to an instructor who is not even from the university, and he has processed the document and unfortunately deleted it. So it is advised to submit your thesis to your supervisor and let him either process it first or send it directly to QEC, as QEC provides 3 chances for one thesis draft to get improved and correct it for higher similarity index. So most of supervisors prefer to directly submit it to QEC instead of checking it himself or herself. So if you delete the earlier processing, you don't think so that this processing has been deleted from everywhere. See, when I have deprocessed this thesis, I found that deleted version as well. Because the process, once you have processed your thesis from Turnitin, it will remain there in Turnitin UK database, and which will be retrieved, which can be accessed at any time. So first of all, please don't give your thesis out of your institution to anybody to process it, because all of your supervisors have Turnitin account at FJWU, and they are.
So I think Dr. Sarita or Ms. Sadia, you can wind up it quickly because of that we are running short of time, and Ms. Nausheen has a problem of connection.
I'm sure there is a lot of other stuff that I know. I will just like to add to what Nausheen was talking. मुझे भी अक्सर जो है वो receive होती हैं requests from external के आपके जो articles हैं they are matched. So certainly I give access to those individuals, but what Nausheen is stressing for the student's perspective is that do not blindly just place your document to whatsoever Turnitin platform that you find. Always approach your supervisor for the consultation. Now that we have again Nausheen, so we will ask her just to really wind up the remaining portion of the, you know, session that she's talking about.
Okay, we can move to the previous slide, please, quickly. I can give you another note. Another important element is that even with can you see the next slide, please?
Yes, it is visible.
Cited and properly referenced work sometimes. Similarity index is higher. Now, why it happened that even when you cite it properly, your index is higher than 19%. We have got 2 such cases in which index was greater than 19% with proper citation, with proper quotations. Upon reviewing the document, it was observed that more than 75% of work is extracted from other sources. Though properly quoted and cited in that case, the contribution of student was only 25%. So upon contributing only 25%, if you think that you will take a full-fledged credit of thesis, it would become a bit difficult. So that is why a limit of 90% is imposed. That means that you can use 19% similar work, while the rest has to be written by yourself. You will be given a credit only for a work majorly done by yourself. Next slide, please. Another common issue is self-plagiarism. As per HEC plagiarism policy, the self-plagiarism is a reuse of significant, identical, or nearly identical portions of one's own work without acknowledging that one is doing so or without citing the original work. So why this is needed?
I think we can conclude it right now, because that was our last slide on self-plagiarism, which actually talks about that you cite actually your own work, for instance.
I have written a thesis, and been awarded a degree for that. So I got credit for a particular work. Now, I want to write a paper while using maximum part of my thesis. Okay, that is fine. People used to write papers from their thesis, but they don't want.
Ms. Nosheen, thank you so much. I think we can wind up. All part is clearly delivered. So just to wind up the session, I would ask if there is any question, if any participants want to ask something from any of the presenters or the facilitators, you can ask. Otherwise, we can conclude it if there is no questions.
Yes, Dr. Adila, please can conclude it. And one last thing, okay. In order to avoid the kind of plagiarism, like self-plagiarism, you must cite your earlier work into your fresh work. If you are using your previous work, you will provide the similarity index report, your thesis, previous work, with clear indications that you have extracted work from your thesis. So in that way, you can avoid with the self-plagiarism. Thank you so much, and I'm so sorry for the inconvenience with the technology. Over to Dr. Adila for concluding the session.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Nosheen, for a very informative session. And I believe it opened up many questions in our minds, and we want to have some more session on to learn how to avoid such kind of plagiarism. As you have rightly mentioned, that beside that, I have quoted and I have cited all the references, still plagiarism is high, and how Turnitin works on this kind of plagiarism issue. So we will definitely have a separate session on it. And with this, I'm very much thankful to all of the facilitators. Thank you, Dr.
Exactly,
Sajda, for sharing your valuable thoughts on how to search for the literature. Many times I also came across with this question. Many students ask that how much literature review is required and how much I need to cite. So my answer is always look at the quality, not quantity. So Dr. Sajda rightly pointed out some quality-based sources which you have to look at, and Dr. Misadia also pointed out on the aspects which you need to cover, how to write and how to rewrite and how to paraphrase your work in order to make a quality-based literature review. So that is actually quality, not quantity. Ms. Sadia, thank you so much for a very informative session on how to write our literature. It's very important and very critical issue, which most of us being in faculty members, we also encountered certain problems regarding paraphrasing, rephrasing, summarizing. And in a very short time period, Sadia, you have very well explained how we can use different techniques to write, to narrate our literature. And the last session was also very productive, although there were some technical issues. We apologize for that. But that was also very informative because of that, after doing that literature review, unless and until QEC will not issue us a clearance certificate from the Turnitin software, we cannot proceed. So many times we are stuck with Ms. Nosheen from the Turnitin report, unless and until it will not appears less than 19 or equivalent to 19, they will not clear or they will not pass our articles as well as the students' thesis. With all this, I'm very much thankful to all of the participants for joining this workshop, for attending this workshop, and I hope you have learned a lot from this workshop. And just to quickly tell you that this is in the start I have mentioned that these are the series of workshops we are going to conduct under the Journal Club and under the Department of Sociology. So the next upcoming workshops will be on questionnaires or the protocol designing, how you have to construct your own questionnaires, how you have to validate, and while designing your questionnaires, what kind of things you have to keep in mind in order to validate or have a good reliability of your questionnaire. And then we will have some data analysis workshops using SPSS and NVivo. So if you are interested to attend those kinds of workshop, you can share your experiences via email, or you can even suggest some more workshops which you are required during your thesis work. So the last, I'm very much thankful to the technical staff, the ITC sports staff for organizing this event and facilitating us for the recording and the live stream. Thank you all. With this, I will end the today's session. Allah Hafiz and stay blessed.
Thank you very much, Dr. Deela. Allah Hafiz.
Allah Hafiz.
Allah
Hafiz. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Allah Hafiz.